Amen. Praise Anybody just glad to be with your brothers and sisters this morning? Amen. Come on, I want you to stand to your feet and give God some praise. Hallelujah. There's some soft hand claps we're hearing in there this morning. I want you to give God some glory and honor. God, thank you for all that you do each and every day. Amen. Has he been good to you? Oh, that was still a little weak. Has he been good to you? Amen. Hallelujah. And no matter what we face or what we go through, sometimes we need to be reminded that he's able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we can ask or think. Amen. Oh, come on. Somebody shout out, he's able.
He's able.
I'm so glad to know that he's able. Hallelujah. All right. Let's sing that together this morning.
Exceedingly, abundantly, above all you could ask or think, according to the power that worketh in you. Up on God, 'cause he won't give up on you. Say,
he's able.
Put those hands together.
Yeah. Oh, so glad to know he's able. Say,
he's able.
Yeah. That's why we celebrate him today. Somebody say, God is able. Say,
God is able to do
just what he said.
Just what he said.
Every promise.
Every promise to you.
So don't give up on God.
Don't give up on God.
He won't give up on you.
He won't give up on you.
Shout it out and say,
he's able.
Come on, clap those hands.
Yeah, yeah. Somebody needs to know that God is able. Say,
he's able. God is able to do
just what he
said he would do.
He's gonna fulfill, yes he will.
He's gonna fulfill
every promise,
every promise to you.
So don't give up on God.
Don't give up on God.
He won't give up on you.
He won't give up on you.
Let the devil know
he's able.
He's able.
Can we sing that part one more time? Say, God is able, yes, he is.
God is able to do just what he said he would do.
He's gonna fulfill, yes, he will.
He's gonna fulfill
every promise.
Every promise to you.
So don't you dare give up on God.
Don't give up on God.
He won't give up on you.
Let
your troubles know
he's able.
Somebody needs to know that God is able.
He's able.
So we're gonna sing this together.
Say, oh, 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 he's able. Sing it to the shout, say he's able.
He's able
to bring you through.
He's able.
He's able.
He's able.
Whatever he promised you.
He's able.
God's not a man.
He's able.
That he shall lie.
He's able.
Neither the son of man.
He's able.
That he shall repent.
He's able.
He said it.
He's able.
He's able.
He's able.
He said it.
He's able.
He's able.
He's able.
I've tried him.
He's able.
And I know.
He's able.
He's able.
He's able.
He's able.
He's able.
Lean on him.
He's able.
Depend on him.
He's able.
Give all your trust.
He's able.
He's able.
He's able.
No matter what you're facing.
He's able.
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 Have you tried him?
He's able.
Have you found out?
He's able.
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 So don't give up on God, 'cause he won't give up on you. Help me say,
don't give up on God, 'cause he won't give up on you.
You may feel like throwing in the towel.
Don't give up on God, 'cause he won't give up on you.
No, say it again, no.
Don't give up on God, 'cause he won't give up on you.
Won't you celebrate that this morning? Amen. Our God is more than able.
Well, good morning, Antioch. God is able. We invite the presence of God, but he's already here because his spirit is in each one of us. Otherwise, we wouldn't be here. God, we come to you this morning thanking you, Heavenly Father, for this past week of life, trials, and tribulations. But Heavenly Father, you saw fit to wake us up this morning to enable us to come into your house of worship, to lift you up, to give you praise, glory, and honor. Bless our pastor as he preaches the word to us this morning, Lord. Open our hearts and mind to receive it, that someone might come in and cry, I yield, I yield, I give my life to God. We thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
And because we're confident in his ability, can we give him our yes? Yes, yes. Yes to your will, Lord. Yes to your way. I'm not afraid of what it means for me to say, because I realize that this life I'm living is not my own. Everything I have belongs to you. Anybody got a yes this morning? Yes, Lord.
Just say yes, you lead the way. I'm not afraid of what it means for me to say, but this life you gave is not my own. Oh, no, no. I'm trusting you to hear my yes and lead me on. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, my life is yours. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, my life is yours. I'll just say yes.
I'll just say yes.
Yes, Lord.
You lead the way.
Yes, Lord.
I'm not afraid of what it means for me to say.
This life you gave.
This life you gave.
Is not my own.
Is not my own.
Yeah.
I'm trusting you to hear my yes and lead me on.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
just say yes.
I'll just say yes.
Yes, Lord.
You lead the way.
Yes, Lord.
I'm not afraid of what it means for me to say.
This life you gave.
This life you gave.
Is not my own.
Is not my own. I'm trusting you to hear my yes and lead me on.
Say yes. Say yes, Lord.
Hallelujah. I mean, y'all know we serve an awesome God. In times when we don't even deserve, He blesses us. He takes care of us. He's our keeper. How many of y'all know he'll keep you? He'll keep you from some stuff. We need that. He'll keep us in some stuff. We need that. And his grace is sufficient.
Holds us.
we have father and daughter duo this morning. Amen. We have another Dudley up there also. Amen. Good. Pastor Jones, fellow ministers, First Lady Jones. Good morning, Antioch.
Good morning.
It's time for our responsive reading this morning. It comes from Hebrews 11th chapter 1 through 4 and 6. And please remain standing for hymn 202. I know who holds tomorrow. I will read the leader, you'll read the congregation, we'll read the last verse together. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. Altogether, but without faith it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. I know who holds tomorrow. Thank you.
Thank you.
Pastor Jones, First Lady Jones, Pastor Thomas, ministers, family and friends, and those watching us online, good morning. If you have a seat next to you, please squinch in. Is it squinch? That's what, Pastor, that's what you said, squinching. People are still coming in. Thank you for joining us today. We are so happy and honored you choose to worship with us. As you can see, I'm very nervous. Okay, so we celebrate the life and legacy of Eloise Elizabeth Williams. Celebration of life service will be tomorrow at 10 a.m. right here at Antioch Missionary Baptist Church. Staying connected. If you are home from college or just graduated from high school, come out and join the excitement and fellowship among our young adult community. We meet in the choir room Wednesday evening at 7 p.m. for our In the Pivot gathering. Learn how to enjoy the stage of your life without compromising your Christian values. If you can't make it in person, get the Zoom link from our YAF Instagram page or the church website. It's going to be a game changer. See you there. I like that. Antioch Missionary Baptist Church of Oviedo and Compass Urban Outreach are partnering to share biblical principle, practical application, and resources that will empower you to manage your finance God's way. Join us here at Antioch on Saturday, August 19th from 10 a.m. until noon as you learn and apply the five pillars of financial discipleship and God's principle on income, debt, generosity, spending, saving, and investing. The usual external outcome is a closer relationship with God. Peace, contentment, improved finances, and more freedom to serve Him. To be eligible for door prizes and receive a handout with valuable tips, you can register from the Antioch website or Facebook page. You can also register at navigatefinances.eventbrite.com or ask Deacon Ken Battles to register you. That part hit me because I know I don't need another coach bag. So, come join one of our small group Sunday school classes. This morning was good. You guys, if you weren't here, you missed it. Minister Montgomery, she did it. You either love him or hate him. Yes, it was good. So next Sunday, come. I don't know if she'd be teaching, but 9 o'clock. Join us this Wednesday for youth and adult Bible study. Bible study will be in the sanctuary and on Zoom. Make a change. Come to the sanctuary on Wednesday. Or you can head to our website for the link. I don't recommend the Zoom. I recommend you come. As always, we ask that you keep our sick, shut-in, and bereaved family in your thoughts and prayers. Is there anyone that has celebrated a birthday since last Sunday? Make some noise. Amen. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you online as well. How about any anniversary? Amen. Happy anniversary. Don't forget to like us on Facebook and subscribe to our YouTube channel at AMBC Oviedo. Do we have any visitors today? If so, please stand so the ushers can give you a visitor's card. Amen. Welcome. Have a great day and a blessed week. And now our video announcement.
Covenant House is an organization that is committed to providing housing and supportive services to young people experiencing homelessness and providing them with love, understanding that at some point in their trajectory, somebody, whether it was a person or a system, didn't love them according to the way they needed to be loved or the way they deserved to be loved.
And being here for our community, it's about the future generation, and I just want to make sure that they're set up for success. And I'm just so happy that we have people that really care about this message and really want to help uplift us.
The last couple of Sundays got up here, I jumped too fast. One time they had some videos and I went too fast, and today I was going to wait, make sure I don't jump up there and mess it up. So this morning I have three short scriptures for you. The first one is from 2 Corinthians 9:7, and it says, "Each of you should give what you have deciding in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver." You've heard that several times. Why, thank you. Acts 20:35, "In everything I did, I showed you that by this kind of hard work, we must help the weak, remembering the words of the Lord Jesus Christ, Jesus himself, who said, 'It is more blessed to give than to receive.'" We've heard that one. Now this one's going to make, this ought to hit your heart here. Deuteronomy 16:17, it says, "Each of you must bring a gift in proportion to the way the Lord has, God has blessed you." Wow, that's something, huh? So if God's blessed you in a mighty way, we need to bless him in a mighty way. And lastly, this goes for, I said it was going to be three, but I read this one. It was pretty cool. It says, "Through Jesus, therefore," this is from Hebrews 13:15. "Through Jesus, therefore, let us continually offer to God a sacrifice of praise, the fruit of our lips that openly profess his name." So if you don't have a whole lot of money to give, remember, I always say that you can give through your talents and the things that you do for the Lord. All right. Yeah, everybody knows the way to present your offerings. We have the envelopes, and then we have the online venue. You can just give it to me if you want to. I'll turn it in, promise. Okay. Let's get a word of prayer. Lord, thank you so much for the opportunity for us to come together yet again to offer you just a little tiny portion of what you've given us. We know we cannot match the blessings that you have given us, Lord, and that we're sorry for. But you know what? Lord, we're going to give you all that we have. We're going to continue to be a mouthpiece for you and working for your kingdom, Lord. We thank you so much. Bless the pastor and his family and all those in this house today. Giving you thanks for everything. We pray in thy name. Amen.
Thank you. Can I get a witness? Amen. Has God been good to anybody? Amen. Matthew chapter 12, verses 1 through 11. Matthew chapter 12, verses 1 through 11. And it reads as follows. At that time, Jesus went on the Sabbath day through the corn, and his disciples were hungry and began to pluck the ears of the corn and to eat. But when the Pharisees saw it, they said unto him, Behold, thy disciples do that which is not lawful to do upon the Sabbath day. But he said unto them, Have ye not read what David did when he was hungry, and they that were with him? How he entered into the house of God and did eat the showbread, which was not lawful for him to eat, neither for them which were with him, but only for the priests. Or have ye not read in the law how that on the Sabbath days the priests in the temple profane the Sabbath and are blameless? But I say unto you that in this place is one greater than the temple. But if ye had known what this meaneth, I will have mercy and not sacrifice, ye would not have condemned the guiltless. For the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath day. And when he was departed thence, he went into the synagogue, and behold, there was a man which had his hand withered. And they asked him, saying, Is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath days? That they might accuse him. And he said unto them, What man shall there be among you that shall have one sheep, and if it fall into a pit on the Sabbath day, will not lay hold on it and lift it out? God bless you and keep you, is our prayer.
You can't tell it. Let me tell it. Come on, they have no idea how much that is in line with what I want to talk about today. If you can't tell it, and if you won't tell it, let me tell it. How good God has been to me. Amen. We ought to start giving God a praise. Amen. Amen. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you so much, God, for allowing us to be here today. We give you praise, God, for letting us see another day we've never seen before. God, we thank you, Lord, for allowing us to be able to gather together in the house of the Lord and gather ourselves around your word, that we might find a word, Lord, wherein, Lord, we could grow and be blessed. We thank you now. Open up our eyes that we may behold wondrous things out of thy law. Father, in Jesus' name, we bind every hindering spirit in the name of Jesus. God, we denounce every spirit that, Lord, would not allow us, God, to hear the word of God plainly. We give you praise. You say, God, that whatsoever, Lord, we bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And whatsoever we loose on earth shall be loose in heaven. Father, in Jesus' name, we loose a spirit of peace, a spirit, God, wherein we could learn and, Lord, glean from your word. We thank you now, for we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Somebody, look at somebody and say, glad you're here. Glad you're here. Glad you're here. Glad you're here. Amen. This morning, I was every Sunday morning, I get to sit in my office and listen at some of the portions of the Sunday school lesson. And this morning, as I was listening to the Sunday school lesson, Evangelist Montgomery was out there tearing it up. Yeah. And one portion in the lesson was talking about a house divided. And that's very important, for there is strength in unity. Jesus said, where there's two or three gathered together in my name, there he'll be in the midst of us. On my way to work, but it is work for me on Sunday. Y'all get to sit back and chill out. On the way to coming here this morning, I was kind of looked at the internet, and it's talked about how the GOP was going to announce their caucus on the day of Martin Luther King, amen, celebration on next year. Then this week we've seen where they struck down what we all have been used to has been great for African American people of color. Affirmative action was struck down by the Supreme Court. Here in this state of Florida, our great governor, has called himself to champion himself against some things in which we hold dear as a people. Where Black history now is being under attack, our heritage is being under attack. There is no more time for us now. We can see things are coming. And I don't know if you are not paying attention to what is going on around us, but you better pay attention to what's going on around us. There's a subtle, and sometimes it becomes to be more brazen, attack on our heritage. But that ain't what I want to talk about. We're going to have to learn how to celebrate one another. We're going to have to start learning to support one another. If there's something in which we could give somebody, amen, praise for or thanks for, I think we ought to start doing that. If we won't do it, who's going to do it? It's time now for us to break this cycle. Amen. Time now for us to rise up as one people. Amen. And to know that we are just as important as anybody else. That the same God in which they serve is the same God that we serve too. Then we must not hate anybody either. Come on, somebody. Amen. There got to be a balance. We're not asking you to love yourself and hate somebody else. We're not asking you to support one another and don't support anybody else. We're just asking us, amen, to know who you are in Christ. That song that they sung, if you don't tell it, let me tell it. I want to talk about an attitude of gratitude. I normally don't do that. I want to talk about an attitude of gratitude. Some of us have a whole lot to be thankful for. Let me say it on this side because I don't think y'all getting it. But a lot of us, you got a whole lot to be thankful for. For some things in which, amen, our grandparents and foreparents went through. And some things they only dreamed about, we're getting to walk into it. And I think that's enough that we ought to give God praise. Amen. I think we ought to thank God for that. I mean, we ought to thank God for being able to sit in a house of worship. Beautiful facility. Awesome musicians that we ought to give God thanks for them, and a choir that we get to sing. We get to look at stuff up on the screen. We didn't have this type of stuff before. Why don't we start learning how to thank God from where He has brought us from? Pastor Thomas read a verse of scripture. It wasn't the one that I thought he was going to read. but it's all the word of God is still good. Turn to John chapter 12, verse 1. St. John chapter 12, beginning at verse 1. St. John chapter 12, beginning at verse 1. It already started to clock on me already. That was just my intro. Y'all owe me some minutes. Amen. John chapter 12, beginning at verse 1, and it read, "Then Jesus, 6 days before the Passover, came to Bethany, where Lazarus was, that which had been dead, whom he raised from the dead. There they made him a supper, and Martha served, and Lazarus was one of them that sat at the table with him. Then Mary took a pound of ointment of spikenard, very costly, and anointed the feet of Jesus and wiped his feet with her hair, and the house was filled with the odor of the ointment. Then said one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, which should betray him, why was not this ointment sold for 300 pence and given to the poor? This he said, not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a thief and had the bag and bare that was therein. Then said Jesus, let her alone. There's a colon, which means that Jesus got real sharp with him. Anytime you see a colon in the Bible, that means nothing else need to be said, but he's going to say something. In other words, Jesus said, let her alone. I believe he looked at Judas. Come on, somebody. See, y'all talking about this gentle Jesus. But sometimes in leadership, you have to be stern every now and then. Sometimes you have to talk to haters like they, come on, somebody, I'm just talking. But he looked at him and says, let her alone. Because I believe that this man, Judas, he had an agenda. He said, let alone. Against the day of my burial has she kept this, for the poor always you have with you, but me you have not always. Much people of the Jews therefore knew that he was there, and they came not for the Jesus' sake only, but that they might see Lazarus also, whom he had raised from the dead. Have there ever been a time that you wanted to tell somebody something, but you didn't know their response was going to be? I mean, you really had something, you were excited about something, God has done something really special for you, and you really wanted to share it with somebody. But you just didn't know how people was going to respond. Many of us get blessed, and you're afraid to show it. You're afraid to even mention it because you don't want nobody to think or say something that you're being this or you're being that. So you keep it to yourself. Come on, somebody. And sometimes God will bless you in such a way that sometimes God will bless you and you sometimes hide it in the garage. You won't wear it to church because you're afraid that some hater gonna say something. You won't go there. You won't spend this because you're afraid somebody gonna say this. And sometimes we live those lives in bondage because we're afraid of what somebody else gonna say. But wouldn't it be kind of crazy that if you blessed your children with something and your kids won't say a word about where they came from, won't wear it? Come on, somebody. If I bought my kids something to enjoy and they don't enjoy it, I'm gonna feel some kind of way about that. I'm just talking about what I'm talking about. If God has blessed you, don't you have God feeling some kind of way? I don't care what they say. If God has blessed you, I'm not asking you to flaunt nothing. I'm not asking you to be arrogant. I'm just asking you to let people know where you've been. I'm just talking about what I'm talking about. I want to talk about an attitude of gratitude. In other words, God, I'm not driving this because I want nobody to think more highly of me than I ought to think. But every time I drive this car, every time I put these clothes on, God, you did this for me. And God, I want to showcase what you've done for me. Come on, somebody. How God has been good to anybody in the house. Come on, somebody. Some of you are working jobs that your granddaddy only dreamed about. Some of you got bank accounts so big that you're afraid to even look at the accounts. Some of you can go to a store and the money is not an issue. You just, your only worry is what color is going to be. And I think we ought to give God praise for that. I'm just trying to introduce us to something. I'm talking about having an attitude of gratitude. You can go to restaurants and eat where you want to eat. You can wear clothes you want to wear. You can... The thing was so exciting. God has blessed you so much. You were so excited. You were worried about what people were going to say. It was so exciting. You felt like, if I don't tell somebody about this, I'm going to bust wide open. You said to yourself, I don't care what them haters think. You had to come to yourself, I don't care what they think. I'm going to tell this. I'm going to share this. I don't care what they think. See, gratitude has a way of making you do or say things that you normally wouldn't. What? Gratitude has a way of making you do or say things you normally would not. But when you're thankful, you don't care what nobody else say. You know, you say, I'm just grateful for that. You know, I don't care how much you hate Ron. If Ron blessed me, I'm gonna bless Ron too. I ain't hate Ron because Ron done blessed me. I don't care what you think about him. Come on. We gonna have to get to the place where we are so grateful that we don't care what nobody else think. I know what God has done for me. And see, an attitude of gratefulness also do something else. It removes fences of selfishness. Huh? It moves the fences of selfishness, which says, you know what, I own this and I own that. And you know what? And I ain't going to give this to show you no appreciation. No, it moves fences. After it removes fences of selfishness where nothing you own or possess should be too great to give in order to show God appreciation. Some of us, praise God, God has been blessed us so much so that you're just afraid to show God how good He is. Let me tell you something. If y'all don't shout on some Sunday mornings, it don't bother me. I shout all by myself. Let me tell you something. I know where I come from. And I know, praise God, that there was times when Amos and the Franklins on my little Benjamin, whatever you want to call them, was crying out. Come on, somebody. I remember some times when we didn't know where the next bill was going to be. I remember some times when I didn't know where I could pay this bill, and I got two more days before I pay this bill. So I'm going to pay this bill hoping that this bill will let me go. See, some of y'all didn't have too good too long. And you know what? I'm not going to let anybody make me feel guilty about what God has done for me. That you can just forget that. No, because you got to know where you come from. And when you remember where you come from, you appreciate where you are and where you're going. See, you got to start calling things that be not as though they were. Say, yes, I'm broke now, but praise God, I'm looking yonder. I'm looking way down here because it ain't going to always be this way. What this has to do, Pastor, with this text? Now, many of us, it's different ways that you can show your appreciation and gratitude to God. Many of us can do it. Some of you don't. Some of us just shout and we do all kinds. But a lot of us can do different things. And just because I don't shout and you do don't mean that I don't appreciate God. Come on, somebody. In Matthew chapter 26 and verse 6, there's a woman that came in, even somebody. Jesus was in the same place, Bethany, and I'm going to show you, I want to show you something real quick because we may get this mixed up when you're doing your Bible study. In Matthew chapter 26, John chapter 12, and in Mark chapter 14, it's speaking of the same incident. And in this incident is where Jesus was in Bethany. And when he was in there in Bethany, he met at Martha's house and at the house of one called Simon the leper, who scholars build that this man, Simon, was actually the father of Martha, Mary, and Lazarus. He was actually the father. He had leprosy somewhere, and I think Jesus may have healed that man.
Well, while he was there at that house, come on, somebody. Mary, at this particular juncture, was the one that came in on his feet. But there's another book in Luke chapter 7, verse 36, where Jesus was invited to the house of a Pharisee. And he was there dining with one called Simon, a Pharisee. And as Jesus was dining and laying there eating, I don't know if I lay down, I might not be able to get up real too fast. But they didn't dine like we dine today. They laid on one side. They laid on one side, and they would have their feet extended. Can y'all hit me again? And when they ate like this toward one another. This is how they ate, and they would eat, and their feet was extended in the back. And while Jesus was there eating with his feet extended in the back, every Pharisee and every leader of Israel would allow misfits or outcasts to come to those feasts because they would invite very important people to eat at those feasts. Jesus was invited to the Pharisee's house, even one named Simon. And sometimes people invite you to your house to see what kind of etiquette you have. You can't go to everybody's house to eat because they want to see whether or not you use a proper spoon. Well, then Jesus was laying there and he was eating, and lo and behold, this woman from the street. She walks up to Jesus and began, even somebody, to wash his feet. And she was so appreciative of what he had done something for her. I remember, she knew or she was expecting him to do something for her. She began to cry and to weep and to wipe his feet with her hair. Come on, somebody. Simon was sitting there looking, said, if he was a prophet. Simon, he opened his mouth. He said, if he was who he say he was, he'd know who touched him. He'll know what kind of woman this is, because Simon, being a Pharisee, they didn't even go in public with their wives. A Pharisees and those of the law did not, it was a disgrace, come on somebody, a dishonor for a man of God or a man of stature to even walk in public with a woman, even their own wives. But in this particular, this woman walks in the house, not following protocol. And she began to wash his feet, and Jesus did not move. Come on, somebody. Simon said to himself, he said, now if he was a prophet, Tara, if he was a prophet, he'll know what kind of woman touching him. Now he going around preaching and all these people following him and all these people showing appreciation. If he were who he say he was, then he'll know what kind of woman touching him. Jesus didn't move. Jesus didn't say anything. See, in that incident, Simon was the one that got indignant. Come on, somebody. Because he wasn't getting indignant with the woman. Simon said something about Jesus. But in John chapter 12, Judas said something to the woman. Come on, somebody. This is why it's important to study the Bible so you won't get it all mixed up. Which means there were two incidents like this that happened in the ministry of Jesus. One happened toward the front of his ministry, and one happened at the latter part of his ministry. And two ladies did the same. Now, this other lady in John chapter 12 was Mary. Now, y'all ain't finished saying that. She's some woman in the street. Mary loved the Lord. She sat at Jesus' feet. But the other woman, Luke, praise God, she did everything that you thought she can do. Y'all ladies know what I'm talking about. Y'all dropped them heads. I want to say something to y'all. Sometimes an expression of gratitude, y'all got this, I hope they put this up. Your expression of gratitude sometimes will upset stingy people who feel it's a bit too excessive. Come on, take up, bring it up. Sometimes your expression of gratitude will upset stingy people. Number two, they would justify their stinginess by their supposed care of the poor and less fortunate. Why are you doing that for them? This money that we had could have been given to the poor, but not one time did they call on the mission ministry. I'm just talking about what I'm talking about. Stingy people, come on, somebody would say that when they do something for somebody else, it was too excessive. Priest Jones, even somebody, y'all getting quiet now. I'm talking about attitude of gratitude. Then number three, they'll say more often than not, they will never participate in helping the poor and the unfortunate. I bet Tara will never find them going out there. Often, most time, number one, they get upset. You're upset, stingy people who feel it's a bit too excessive to bless somebody. Number two, they will justify their stinginess by their supposed care for the less fortunate. And number three, often they never participate in the missions ministry or the outreach ministries. Then number four, they will get upset when they feel a recipient of the gratitude is unnecessary. You don't need that, Wolf. You got a nice car. Why they blessing you like that? You don't need that. I'm just talking about what I'm talking about. I just think in the church, among us as a people, we need to start learning how to celebrate people and stop being jealous of somebody else. It's amazing that sometimes you can't even say, Brother Mobley, you did a good job, and let somebody else over here say, well, I did something too. He ain't said nothing about me. I'm just going over here. It's amazing if I say, Ken Battles, you're doing a great job, that somebody on the other side would say, I did something too, and you ain't said a word. But when you learn how, praise God, to accept somebody and learn to celebrate somebody else, your time is coming. Sometimes what God will do, he'll do that so you can see just how much you don't deserve to be blessed. Sometimes we block our own blessing by getting jealous of somebody who got something, come on somebody, that maybe what you had coming was going to be far more than the appreciation we gave to Battles if you'd have shut your mouth and celebrated him. We got two people to clap. But the Bible here in John chapter 12 exposed the hypocrisy of Judas Iscariot. Come on, somebody. He was a perfect example of stingy people. Come on, somebody. Stingy people sitting there being nothing but a hypocrite. John chapter 12 and verse 5 says these words. Here's Judas. Why not? Here's Judas with a hypocritical self. Why was not this ointment? So you could have got more for it than that. But Judas did not appreciate Jesus. He was hanging on for what he can get. There's some people that hang on you only for what they can get for being around you. But if that ever get in jeopardy, they'll hate you. Come on, somebody. Put it back up here. Amen. And he says, here's Judas talking. He said, it could have been given to the poor. And this he said, not that he cared for the poor, but that joker was a thief. In other words, sometimes what you criticize somebody else for is the very thing that you're guilty for in your heart. You remember one time they were talking about, you remember Jim Baker, amen, somebody, when Jim Baker failed, and you know how Jimmy Swaggart and all them jumping on the bandwagon were beating them up and couldn't find out they all had skeletons in their closets. You better be careful about what you accuse somebody else of, because somebody might open up your closet and see the same thing. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. If you think somebody a crook, it's good chance that you're a bigger crook yourself. I'm just talking, y'all. I'm talking about having an attitude of gratitude. So the next time that somebody get a praise or somebody gets something nice, don't you open your mouth. Shut up, because God could be waiting for you to bless you. I got two people that's just, I don't care what you say. The extent of God's mercy, too, will determine the extent of your service and praise on his behalf. The extent of God's mercy to you will determine the extent of your service and praise on his behalf. In other words, when you know you should have been dead, I'm going to go on this side. If you know there's some things that you did that other people died for and God saved you, somebody, when you know, praise God, amen, somebody, that somebody even got a venereal disease and they died from it, but you didn't. When you know, come on here, somebody, when you know that car, amen, somebody, that 2 minutes before you got there, somebody else got killed, but God spared you. When you know, praise God, when somebody else was taking a sip and they still drunk right now, but you haven't. Come on, somebody. When you know just how good God has been to you, it gives you reasons. Why y'all sitting there acting so cold? None of y'all have never been through nothing. You can't remember a time when if God would have let you do what you've been doing, if God had let you stay in that place, you would be on skid row right now. You would... Every time I come to church, I always remember from whence I came. You know why I'm so passionate about preaching? You know I'm so passionate about... Because I know God has been good to me. I got some of my friends that got killed, praise God. Bullets flying by me. Come on, hear somebody. But God kept me. Class of 1975, about 2 or 3 years after we had graduated, a lot of my classmates got killed and dead on drugs, messed up. But look what God did for me. And some of the same things that they did, some of the ones that got killed and messed up right now, I also participated with them. God saved me, but they, come on, somebody. Some of y'all sitting there like y'all been having like this all the time. It's, you know, y'all just been having like this all the time. So you ain't never did, and you ain't never had some sex outside of marriage. You ain't never drink. You ain't never had no joy. See, you've been too good. That's why you can't talk to me. I want to talk to somebody that done been through. I want to talk to somebody that done had a, know their life was a man. I don't want to talk to you. I don't want to talk to you that ain't never had. And I don't want to talk to nobody that prayed. You can't talk to me, ain't never done that. I want to talk to somebody who can tell me, praise God, my life was a mess. I messed up, but look what God has done for me. And that's why I want to talk to somebody who can tell me, I know God is good. I know God can deliver. I want to talk to you if you've never been through nothing. I want to talk to the person who can tell me, my kids have always been there. My kids messed up, and sometimes I stayed up all night. I want to talk to somebody who know what it feel like, praise God, to have marital problems, have kids problems, some drug problems, some health problems. But I want to talk to that person because when God delivers you, you know how to tell it. 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 Y'all sit down for a minute. I'm tired. But it bothers me that when I look in the church and somebody be around trying to find stuff on you, hoping that they can find some and doing research and checking it out to make sure that I can scandalize you, to make you look bad. You better watch because you dig one ditch, you better dig two. You better watch what you do. Praise God. You better watch yourself. You better watch what you do because God is watching you. You better learn how to praise God. You better learn how to give God because just because you wasn't there, you could have been there. I don't care what you say. I'm mad with you right now. I wish you would have preached something else this morning. I was looking for something else. No, this is what you need to hear, though. Yeah. Because somebody in this room is robbing yourself of God's blessing. just because you don't have an attitude of gratitude. Whatever, if you got a penny more than what you had yesterday, that's more. And sometimes what God will do, I'm going to tell you what he'll do sometimes. Sometimes what God will do, God will give somebody a raise right on the job. Come on, somebody. Because God controls everything. And you sitting there saying, you know what, I did more reports than she did. I was there on time just like they was on time. And they're going to get the promotion. Why I don't get promotion? But promotion, remember, come from the Lord. It don't come from the east and from the west. And sometimes God will stretch you to see whether or not you're worthy of it. He'll see sometimes when God want to entrust you with something, he want to know how well you can handle what somebody else got. Come on, somebody. So many of us are robbing ourselves of what God really wants to do in your life based on how you treat others who have what you thought you ought to have. You be careful. You be careful. The next time that somebody is blessed, come on, somebody, you bless them as if your time is coming. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. You bless them and keep saying the word they say on a basketball court. I'm up next. Come on, somebody. You got to have I'm up next attitude. Well, I'm up next. Praise God. He's starting right now, but I'm up next. You remember Michael Jordan, praise God, was cut on his basketball team in high school? Come on, somebody. He didn't complain about it. Praise God. But wait till his time comes. The coach said he wasn't qualified. He wasn't good enough. But praise God, not only did he excel, amen, and the guys that was more important to him at the time, you don't even know their name. But Michael Jordan, he's not even playing no more, and we still want people to be like Mike. I'm just giving y'all my intro, and I'm going to give you a couple more things and let y'all get. Now, this lesson kind of bleeds over into what we were talking about last. You remember the man that Jesus had healed from the demonic? The man was so appreciative. He said, listen, when Jesus, he said, I want to go home with you. I really appreciate what you did for me. These demons was driving me crazy. I really want to go home with you. And guess what Jesus did? It's amazing that Jesus told this man something. Now, notice, when Jesus got ready to get in the boat in Mark chapter 5, 18, and when Jesus was coming to the ship, he that had been possessed with the devil prayed him that he might be with him. Howbeit, Jesus suffered him not, but said to the man, go home. Some of y'all just need to go home. Some of y'all so busy worried about church, carry yourself home. Some of us are so busy about what's here that we're not worried about what your home life is. Jesus said, no, he said, I don't need you right here. I need you to go home. Go home and tell them. If you want to preach, you go home and preach. I got a young pastor of mine over in Sanford, a young pastor. They call me Pops now. And he got one man in church that giving him all kinds of hell. The man about 87 years old. Somebody got up and called him to preach. He should be the pastor, not the young man. He can hardly walk. He just barely getting around. Tell me he's going to preach somebody. And every time this young man do something, the young man say blue, he say gray. The young man say green, he say white. And the young pastor, he just stressed. I said, stop stressing over him. Stop stressing over him and go on and preach what God told you to preach. He said, Pastor John, but then man, he gets some money. Every time he got something to say, I said, stop stressing over him. And sometimes you just need to start at home. Then it spread abroad. You need to start home. Anyway, take care of your own house first. Here it is. He says, go home. Jesus told the man said, I want to go. And Jesus said, no, you can't go with me. He said, go home. Here it is. He says, go home to thy friends and tell them how great things the Lord has done for thee and hath compassion on thee with mercy. Note, this verse clearly indicates that this man, the mess he was in, he deserved it. Come on, somebody. Because Jesus said, tell them what God, compassion God. In other words, the mess you're in, somehow this man got in, he the one deserved it. But the mess, when you know that what you have suffered because you deserve it and God brought you from it, that makes you want to praise God just that. When some of the things I went through, some things I dealt with in my life, some of the pain, the hurt that I suffered, it wasn't because nobody made me do it. The devil didn't make me do it. I did it. Some of us just need to own up to some things. Sometimes you just need to own it. Just so you know what? I'm in this mess in my life because of the choices that I made. And Jesus said to this man, he says, go home and tell him what good things the Lord has done for you. Guess what? The very people in that region, Pastor Wolf, told Jesus to leave. Powerful is Jesus preached, but his preaching was not as powerful as this man's testimony in that same region. I know you ain't finna say this, but I'm finna say this. Sometimes when people don't want to hear what Pastor Jones says, you go home, the people that know how you used to be, the people know how messed up your life was, you go back to your hometown and let them see what good things the Lord has done for you. And I guarantee you, it'll get their attention. Come on, somebody. Sometimes people are more blessed and the effect of the gospel is more powerful when it comes from somebody who knows that what I was in, I should have deserved, I deserved it, but praise God, I look at you, Hosea, and I can see God has blessed you. But I remember when you were nothing but a jerk. I remember when you was a mess. But I look at you now, you're looking so handsome. You're looking like your life is all together. That speaks volume to a person. Let me go back up here. It speaks volume to a person that can look at somebody's life and know where you came from. And can say, there is no way that you could have got out of that without God doing something. And the Bible says that when they do that, you'll be ready to give an answer. Come on, somebody. Be ready to give an answer to anybody that asks you of the hope that's in you. So the next time you go back home, the next time that people look at your life and say, I don't know how he did it, I don't know how you came out of it, but the next time, you be ready to give an answer of the hope that you have in you. You tell somebody, and some, can I talk to the ladies for a minute, ladies? All ladies, hold your hands up for a minute. Make sure you no rocks in your hand. Ladies, sometimes we can be knuckleheads. Yes, yes. J.I., maybe I should just left that out. Yes, yes, yes. Yeah. But the lady says in 1 Peter chapter 3, it says, a woman can win her husband without even saying a word while he behold how you conduct yourself. In other words, ladies, you speak more volume to us not by your mouth, but how you carry yourself. And if you want to win that knucklehead, stop talking so much. Just saying. Stop talking so much and walk the walk. Look, all the men clapping. The ladies ain't saying nothing. Like, I'm waiting for you to get outside that dope house. I got something for you. Hey, security, y'all with me, bro? Are you with me? Oh, yeah. Are you with me? But ladies, you can win us because the Bible says that while he behold your chaste conversation, which means that you speak more to a guy, not by what you say, but what we look. Because God made every man to be analytical. We judge things by what we see. That's why some girls are wondering why they can't get a good man. You're showing them the wrong stuff. You keep, I'm just going to say this. If you say every time I turn around, I ain't getting nothing but dogs, stop feeding them gravy train. Come on, somebody. You be careful of how you present yourself because a man looks at how you dress. He looks at your demeanor. He looks at how you conduct yourself. We look at y'all. God made us analytical. We look at things. We analyze things. We pay attention to body language. Come on, somebody. Y'all, Some dude sent a sin. I ain't saying no. I ain't with him, honey. Some men hit their wife like that, baby. I ain't with him. I got to eat today. I got to eat. Tomorrow is our intimate night. I ain't finna mess this up. But I'm gonna go deeper into this in our next message. So y'all bear with me as we look at some things about how that when you want to appreciate God and when you want to appreciate some things that God has done for you, there will always be people around you is going to despise your act of appreciation. Come on, somebody. So you be thankful. When you leave this place today, I want you to go. The next time you go to somewhere eating and you can afford it, if you see somebody in front of you or behind you reaching the pocket trying to find and count the pennies, you say, Lord, I used to be there too. Give me their ticket. Come on, somebody. Come on. I'm just saying. Learn how to bless. And today God told me, somebody in here, God really want to bless you, but you don't allow a spirit of stinginess to rest on you. And you're so busy trying to get back. You're so busy trying to hold back that what you're doing, the very thing you're trying to keep somebody else from, what you're really doing is keeping yourself from it. Have an attitude. Come on, somebody, say it with me. An attitude of what? Look at somebody and say, have an attitude of gratitude. Look at somebody else on the other side and say, have an attitude of gratitude. Now give God a praise. Give God a praise. Give God a praise. Everybody standing. While our counselors are coming, I want this, everybody as a part of this ministry, I know sometimes I upset the apple cart, so to speak. Because when God makes you, called you to be a visionary, sometimes you see things that other people can't see. Sometimes our vision sometimes disturb other people. But I'm looking at us as a people. I see young men like that, young kids that's over in the nursery. I'm 60. Something. I got more years now, according to the Bible, got more years behind me than in front of me now. I ain't got no more time for no drama. I ain't got time for that now. Could I borrow him for a second, young man? Yes. Just come and son. He almost taller than me. I'm on the steps. Listen, we ain't got time. We six, all of us, is fifth and over. Why you still trying to keep drama going? You got more years behind you, not in front of you. It's time now for us to be looking here. I want this young man to take the baton of life, and I want him to carry it. I want young ladies to know, amen, that they can do great things. They're telling us now that affirmative action, you ain't gonna come to this job no more. We don't need no quota no more. And if you got the same degree as she got, 9 times out of 10, there is systemic racism. And you walk in, I don't care what your degrees is. Y'all hear me? I know I'm talking about. I talk to college kids. My daughter was just as educated as anybody else. I'm going to shut up, y'all. She walked in the same job and sometimes had more education. And the person got out of college later than her. Didn't have the experience she got. But guess who got the job? Y'all hearing me? And those of you that got the job, don't you think you're so good? Like we got somebody named Tim Scott. Done forgot. He's always trying to wipe out his mind where we come as a people. I'm not going to let us forget it. I'm not going to do it, praise God. Because we got some young people following us, like this young man here. I want him to do far better than I did. I want him to have things far more than I had. I ain't going to be jealous of him. I want him to excel. But I got to blaze a trail for him. I got to blaze a trail for him. I got to let this young man know that if I did it, you can go further than me. Come on, man. Come on, let's give him a hand. Thank you, man. Thank you, man. Thank you. Thank you, man. If there's anybody here who's never trusted Christ, he makes a difference. Are you here? Pastor, I want to give my life to the Lord. And if you're here, I want you to come. If you want to join this ministry, you can come. Those of you via the internet, if you want to write us and let us know that you gave your life to the Lord, or let us know that you want to join this ministry, or you're hoping we can help you find a church, we'll find a church for you. Whatever your needs are, would you come now? I'm going to give you a couple more minutes. Would you come now? Let me pray for you. Father, in Jesus' name, I tried my best to give what you gave me. And God, I'm asking in Jesus' name that you would, Lord, inflame fire and a zeal in the hearts of the people that's here to know, Lord, that we're in, Lord, a battle. And God, if a house is divided, Lord, there's no way we can stand. God, we can see all around in this nation something is happening. It's falling back to what our foreparents experienced. Lord, it's been done in a more subtle way, more educated, more people that got even more subtle tongues, more laws are being passed. And God, I'm asking for you to, you kept us back then, and God, we believe you can keep us now. So God, in Jesus' name, I pray that you'll make this congregation a token of your good. Let Antioch be a place where people can come and be blessed and be fed the word of God. Let this be a place where they come and know that God, that in Jesus' name, they know that you have no respect to a person. Let them come to this place and know that they're going to walk out this place feeling, Lord, they're going to feel as if, God, they have been edified. And Lord, they have been inspired. I give you praise now. I commit this congregation to you in the name of Jesus. And let the church say, amen. God bless you. God bless you.